director, John Samuel, for inviting me to join in commemorating the 38th anniversary of the Institute for Asian Studies. It gives me great pleasure to celebrate the book release and the distinguished contributions of Dr. David C. Buck to the study of Tamil literature, both ancient and modern, and his impressive record of translations from Tamil into English. As I'm sure you are familiar, Dr. Buck has experience working in very early texts, especially in the case of his 1997 publication, Stolen Love, co-translated with belated Dr. K. Paramasivan, which brought two texts to the English audiences. First, Iranar Akaporal, the earliest extant verses written in the Kovai genre style, the Pandi Kovai. I am particularly fond of this combination of Aham grammatical treatise with Kovai verses because my own study, Material Devotion in the South Indian Poetic World, will be published next month, and in it, I examine natural landscapes, materiality, botanical imagery, and sensations of devotion as described in 9th century Manikavasakar's Tirukovayar. Tirukovayar has elements in common with Irayanar Ahakoral, as it is an Ahakoral Kovai. It is in common with Pandi Kovai, as it is the first complete Kovai genre poem. Tirukovayar is also common with Buck's more recent translation of his Kuttralak Kuravanci, which we celebrate today. Tirukovayar and Kuttralak Kuravanci speak about Aham love. Both texts celebrate the natural landscapes and sacred cities of Tamil South India, including Kuttralam, and both are significant representations of Tamil's Chittralakyam, or minor literary genres. Depending on your list, there are almost 100 minor genres in the Tamil literary canon, including Pillai Tamil, Kovai, Ula, and of course, Kuravanci. The plot of Kuttralak Kuravanci takes us to the breathtaking, gushing waterfalls of Kuttralam. There, we follow the drama of a heroine in love with Shiva as he is manifest in the local form of Kuttralam, and the prophetic character of the fortune teller woman. David Buck's translation brings us the opening arrival of our hero, Shiva, of Kuttralam. And at the wonderful sight of the hero, the heroine, who is herself quite lovely, youthful, and beautiful, she falls deeply in love with this lord while he is on a proud procession through the city. Like in much of Aham poetry, the lovely heroine languishes and pines for her absent hero. She is lovesick and requests the help of her natural messengers, like the moon, the coil bird, and even the wind, to help unite her with this hero. Finally, with the involvement of her confidant, her Tori, the heroine is introduced to the fortune teller. With Buck's translation, English language audiences can hear the description of natural landscapes, the lifestyle and tricks of the fortune teller, and the fortune teller's community. When the Kuravanci finally reads the future of our heroine and predicts the anticipation and the union of the lovers between the heroine who pines and the powerful divine hero of Kuttralam, of course, she is handsomely rewarded with ornaments and jewels and a story to tell her own husband when she meets him while bird catching on the way home again. Again, we enjoy more clever banter in the verses that close Kuttralak Kuravanci. This text and Dr. Buck's translation are an important one in its own right, but also as a precursor to a number of other Kuravanci. So in order to honor his Kuravanci, I would like to link it to its relative in the literary family. For example, the Tamil Christian poet Vedanayagam Shastriar, based in Tanjore, wrote his most famous poem in the same genre many years later, that is Kuravanci Bethlehem. There is another Kuravanci called Sendil Kuravanci that takes place in Tiruchendur. There, the heroine, Madana Mohini, is seeking the attention of Lord Murugan after she sees him in a procession. Once their union is predicted by the fortune teller, Madana Mohini showers the woman with gifts and keeps with the Kuravanci plot structure. There is also one Tirumalai Andavar Kuravanci and the Virali Malai Kuravanci, which both became very famous for their excellence in music. Additionally, the Kuravanci poems are tied to local traditions of theater and dance performances. Although Kuttralak Kuravanci is most famous for its literary value, it is also tied to these streams of Tamil's creative cultures, such as music, dance, and theater. Finally, this text and its performances engage both classical and regional folk vocabularies with masterful results. In general, as we rediscover and study the rich corpus of Tamil Chittralakyam, and in the specific case of David C. Buck's translation of Kuttralak Kuravanci that we celebrate today, these texts, this poetry, are windows into the literary, cultural, religious, linguistic, and collective imaginations of South Indian artistry and literary heritage. Indeed, each verse is a wellspring of information to study and also a source of great enjoyment for people local and foreign who are dedicated to Tamil literary expression, past, present, and future. Nandri, thank you kindly for your attention.